Today's deliberations have afforded us an opportunity to infuse biblical principles into the new dispensation, and as enunciated in my inaugural address on 24 November 2017. Since taking office as the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, I have used every opportunity to preach the message of peace, love, unity, and forgiveness. I believe this is the same message that you preach every single day.
Amen.
As we approach the harmonized elections later this year, I urge the church to reach out to all its congregants with the message, peace, love, and unity.
Amen.
I will soon be meeting with my fellow leaders of political parties, including the Young Chamisa, to drum up the same message that all of us, as leaders of our respective political parties, must actively shun violence, but rather exercise tolerance. And I repeat, there is no need for violence. There is no room for violence. It is ungodly. This is a new era. We need to be united. We need to love each other. We need to share. And the best argument, the best idea, should take the day.
Amen.
Furthermore, the Holy Bible unequivocally tells us to stay united, for the simple reason that a house that is divided against itself cannot stand.
Amen.
As has often been said, love and unity correlate. For where there is no love, there is no unity. I thank you as church leaders for instilling in me such tried and tested principles, for without them I could not be what I am today. Having elaborated on the need for love and unity in nation building, I now want to turn to the focus of the new dispensation. The priority of my government is to resurrect our economy. Though remaining true to our past, it is time to boldly embrace the future. We are therefore embarking on a journey with the objective of an end state characterized by real growth and increased investment, with overarching objectives of empowering our people with the skills, opportunities, and jobs. As a key component of this drive, we'll be opening up Zimbabwe as a preferred destination for foreign direct investment by engendering an open, free, and transparent economy. In a nutshell, the era of an inward-looking Zimbabwe is over. Let us cross the River Jordan together and go into Canaan. In the same vein, I wish to point out that real change takes time, and it will not, therefore, occur overnight.
Yes.
Outsiders have always marveled and testified to the fact that Zimbabweans are dynamic, hardworking, and entrepreneurial people. I have no doubt that people, together, we will drive this great country to success by unlocking the vast potential reposed therein and build a new, prosperous and democratic Zimbabwe for all. In the last 3 months, we have managed to attract commitments of up to $3 billion United States dollars worth of foreign direct investments in our country. To sustain this momentum and further enhance the activity, I vowed to have zero tolerance to corruption. I passionately believe that it is time for all Zimbabweans to take the path of truth, honesty, and integrity. It takes time to weed the corrupt.
Amen.
But if we all agreed that it's cancerous, we will succeed. To buttress this, I believe that we have a responsibility as government to lead our people with integrity. This requires a God-fearing people who are led by an infusion of biblical principles in all their endeavors. As highlighted in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 to 2, and I quote, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed." Among others, we have the chairman here, Mr. Nari, who is with us, who has given us some talk. I was discussing with the chairman that indeed, Mr. Chairman of the Commission, you need the prayers of the change.
Amen.
More often than not, they make important input in fostering restraint, temperance, responsiveness, and responsibility in governance and other bodies. I hope that it is the duty of churches to urge commissions to refrain from vindictiveness, but instead promote fairness. The Bible says, it's not some people may think it is the physical clapping. The church's voice. He has been making stringent calls for the commissions to be guided by equity and soberness in all their dealings and never to be propelled by emotions.
Amen.
Section 60, subsection 1 of our national constitution states that every person has the right to freedom of conscience, which includes freedom of religion and belief. But we don't take this freedom too far. I remember in 1956, when me and my cousin, when we completed standard 6, went to collect our results. Our teacher who was teaching us what they called social science at the time, told us that your parents pay taxes. These are the taxes which are used to build the schools, to build the bridges, and to build roads. This is the money which comes from your parents' taxes. Now, my father was also paying taxes. So when he went to Lusaka, at the Ministry of Education headquarters, we said this tarot, our parents contributed. So we walked in the middle of the road. And a car came and they said, we have an equal right to walk on the road because our father pays taxes. So it was a white man. Fortunately, the brakes, he stopped. When he came up, we see that he was going to beat us. My cousin was more brave. He remained, I ran away. And he was kicked. So we said, when we came together, I said, but that teacher said we have a right to use the word, because our parents teach us, and we contribute in terms of taxes. So the freedom is there, but there are things which derogate that freedom. Like there are rules of using the road. Don't say because you pay taxes, you can walk on the road at any side. No, there are rules.
Amen.
This applies. In light of these fundamental provisions, my government remains committed to upholding these constitutionally enshrined rights of freedom of worship. In this same vein, therefore, I want to exhort the senior church leaders to mold society's moral fiber, transform people's lives, and help break the vicious cycle of poverty, depression, animosity, bitterness among our people that currently engulf some of our people.
Amen.
Turning to the economic growth and the wealth creation, it is vital for each one of us to put our shoulders to the wheel according to our different but complementary endeavors.